if I found out that they had this incredible room and it was the entertainment, it was designed to be the entertainment portion of their house, and all they had in it were a few chairs, I would advise them not only to get a bigger TV, provided they could afford it, but also other components and speakers to make it, that's a cross-sell. Does that make sense? High impact headlines. Remember the process I had you work on yesterday with the headlines? Well, that was just a starter. Headlines, or their equivalent, and you'll remember I showed you their equivalent was the first paragraph of a letter, the subject line in an email, the first paragraph or two somebody says when they have a sales presentation, the first things they're said when somebody walks into your shop, the signage on your door or at your trade show. I want you to start using that list of 100, there's like 100 or 137, and start making more more examples where you translate what you read there that are generally written about some other product or service or business and make them apply to you. You should do this exercise weekly for a while because it's going to be that valuable, and this is going to make you and your business a ton of money because you'll use what you end up with many ways. By the way, when you're doing this, I suggest you go. We're going to start today just to get you started so I have the confidence and the comfort that I can trust that you're well on your way and we've done our job for you and we've put you down the path and you're ready to fly. But what you should do when you go home is build yourself many copies of this. Build it out bigger so you got plenty of room and start doing it. And I would do it by hand. I would not do it on your computer, and let me tell you why. Research has proven, I'm not sure why, but I am sure that doing it by hand makes it come alive and go through your brain a totally different way than when you do it on a keyboard. And you don't want to just do it fast. You want to do it so it will instill itself and take root and be really part of you. The next page is specific measurable benefits. Write 5 ways your product or service adds specific measurable benefit or value to your client. Now, today as you're filling this out, you probably aren't going to know exactly because you've really not yet analyzed what kind of a benefit, productivity and profitability and joy that your clients are getting. But you can guesstimate, even if you put a hypothetical in there just to start it, it'll force you to start thinking that way. Does that make sense? Good? Okay, good. Okay, thank you. Next, advantages over competition. Write 10 advantages you either have or can create now that you understand how to do it with the materials you've got over your competition. And they can be tangible advantages, they can be intangible. People buy for 2 reasons. Remember the strategy of preeminence? Partially for a result, partially for a good feeling, or a better feeling, or a more secure feeling, or a more competent feeling, to feel better about themselves, to be special, whatever it is. So deal with that. And by the way, you are welcome as you're doing this, because this is the key finality. This is the last big module in what you're experiencing with me. This is the big crescendo and conclusion. So you're welcome to go back as you're doing this and review some of the notes in the workbook, and just if you need some triggers, and we're going to give you 2 solid hours to do this before we start seeing how well you've done and we do some table work. So you got 2 hours here, because if I wait for you to go home, half of you won't do it. No disrespect, but you won't do it. If I force you to start it and then read examples to people and maybe go to the mics, we'll see if we have time, you're going to be so obligated and so committed in a public way that you're going to be psychologically necessitated to go home and complete it and then apply it. And as it works and it validates and you start making more money and seeing what we call wins or successes, you're going to be motivated to keep improving it. And then our job will have been complete.
Okay, can I make just 1 additional point to
this? Of course.
But as you're filling this out, your business is at a certain point in a certain state. What will happen as you start to look at your business differently, you start to try things in your business will evolve, your business will grow, your business will expand. At that time, you'll see different opportunities, you'll see your business in a different way. So it's important that you do it here, finish it when you go home, and mark on your calendar 30 days from now to do it again, and then every quarter, at least 4 times a year, go through the same process, because your business will grow, your competition will change.
And your sense of possibility, and your goals, and your vision, and your ambition will grow, not linear, it'll grow geometrically, so you gotta revisit it, because this is an interim strategy. This is a strategy to get you from where you are right now to the next level. But if you do this right, you'll be able to actually catapult past levels. You can go from level 2 to level 4 or level 8 if you have a strategy that's very integrated and you follow it.
The biggest indicator that we have found between the people that succeed extraordinarily, profitably, and just exponentially by going through this program versus the people who just succeed a bit are the people that do this on a continuing process.
And they don't stop. They keep reviewing it, improving it, raising the bar, course correcting. I mean, again, the beauty of all this, I told you, it's more science than art. There's no one in this room that can't apply a lot, if not all of this, in a direct or a modified way to whatever business you got now, and can't transform that business over a period of a few short years into either a giant, an empire, or at least a very, very massively profitable and very, very impressive and satisfying and major contributing success in your market or community, country, or the world. It's only limited by what you can envision. The next one, make a list of all the specific direct, indirect competition you have for the problem your product or service or company solves and what their chief individual appeals or advantage to the buyer are. You can't get focused on counter-programming to know what they've got that you don't. And realize that the problems that you solve for people may be singular. Like, I may have a weight loss problem that your supplement solves, but the means to solve it are many. There's lots of other supplement companies. There's exercise regimen I could do. There's liposuction to suck it out. There's clothes I can buy to make me look flatter. I can wear a girdle and suck it in. And those are all direct or indirect competitors. They're also great sources of leads that you can joint venture with. But this process is going to force you to just laser right in on all these opportunities that you wouldn't probably come up with on your own if I sent you home. This is a really cool document. Next. Now tell the 5 things everyone should look for in a product or service like yours without directly referencing your product. This is going to help you create the buying criteria that your product or service or company always satisfies, that almost nobody else does, and it's going to guide the prospective buyer to a buying criteria or a series of expectations that you will be able to fulfill better than anybody else. Next, provide 5 metaphors or similes that analyze or illustrate what else having your product or service in their lives is like. Do you remember yesterday morning when I came on stage and I was talking about the problems and was trying to explain some examples, and I used examples of an airplane and I used examples of something else? What else did I use yesterday, Spike, in the morning? Well, I used 3 or 4 examples. Examples that was like this. It's sort of very close to that. That's a metaphor or simile. Remember I said the mind works that way best when you give them an example that it's like, so they can instantly relate? Oh, one more thing I forgot to tell you. And I'm shamefully sorry that I can't really hear what you're hearing, because I don't know how closely it mirrors what I'm saying. But one of the things that I do all the time is talk in what's called triplicates. 3 different successive versions of the same word. I do it for 1 major reason. Today I'm doing it for 2. The major reason I do it is that research and science has shown if you present a concept in 3 different ways, it has almost a hypnotic effect in penetrating the mind of the prospect, and they get it. The reason I'm doing it here is I figure if I say something 3 different ways, one of them will be a word that the translator can most easily convey to you. Okay, next, elevator pitch. If you're riding up 10 stories and you had 30 seconds on an elevator to tell people the biggest benefit and positioning of your product or service, what would you say that would excite them enough to want to give you their card and say, give me a call? Now state it, reduce it down to one sentence. This is a great process. The next page, you're revealing your new strategy and you're defining what it's going to look like. The next page, the tactic. You're coming up with what tactics, what methods, what elements from all the things I taught you earlier in this week, you're going to combine together initially. And remember I told you, you can't use all of them. You don't need to. If you're using none of them now and I've given you 50 and you pick 5 or 6 good ones to start with, then you start one at a time until you get it perfected or at least validated and then installed systematically, and then you add another one and then you add another one. You're going to be so far ahead of all your competitions and so dramatically far ahead of where you were when you walked in this room. So you can go through all these things. Get what tactics you're going to use for lead gen, for referral system. What tactics are you going to use to try to bring clients in on a break even? What tactics are you going to try to use to incorporate into your risk reversal and your guarantee? And I'm going to skip through these because there's just lists and lists and lists. Hold on. How are you going to improve your average transaction size? How are you going to help your team gain sales ability? And this just goes through and asks lots of questions. Hold on. There's a section called a superior access vehicle. That's what's going to get you greater access to your market than anyone else. Remember I told you, for example, that if you write a book and you send it to somebody as a gift, that credentializes you, that gives you a higher, more credible and prestigious access than just calling cold or sending a brochure? Well, this is self-explanatory, so go through it. Then you've got, I think around 190 or 191, you've got a flow. It shows you the lead flow. You bring a lead in, you make your primary offer, you upsell or cross-sell them. If they can't afford or don't need it, you downsell or find some ethical way to reclaim the investment you've made in attracting and generating that client.
Jay, there was a bit of confusion the other night about upsells and cross-sells, and I gave an explanation, but would you mind just going through it?
Sure. An upsell and a cross-sell. An upsell is normally a single product going to a higher level. Is that what you told me? So let's say that I came in to buy the basic advertised 24-inch television. And it's a very good buy for $400. But upon interacting with the prospect as their most trusted advisor, I found out that they have all their friends over every Saturday to watch sports, that they watch movies on the DVDs, that they have sometimes 10 family members over, that they have a very large room in their house that is very commanding and is a perfect mini theater, I would advise them to move up to bigger size, better resonation, better sound. That's an upsell. If I found out that they had this incredible room and it was the entertainment, it was designed to be the entertainment portion of their house, and all they had in it were a few chairs, I would advise them not only to get a bigger TV, provided they could afford it, but also other components and speakers to make it, that's a cross-sell. Does that make sense? Is that helpful? Raymond?
Yes.
Okay, good. So in here, you're going to be able to see what you do when they come in. The offer you make, what you take them up to, what you take them down to, always based on being their most trusted advisor, never based on manipulating them. Page 192, building your back end. You'll be able to figure out what back ends make sense. And it doesn't matter today whether those products or services are things you own or manufacture or not. Figure out what is appropriate because you can always get access, control, rights, joint ventures, almost anything that your market would benefit from, and that is a logical extension of what you sell. Then validation, there's a little section here on doing research to create preeminence, and you can read that later. I wouldn't read it today. Then testing. You're going to figure out all the things you want to test and the order and priority you want to test them. I don't know what page that's on. The next is systematizing, marketing tactics. You're going to figure out what you're going to do, what it's trying to accomplish, how many ways you're going to test it. Then a couple of pages further, it says maximum strategic objective. What do you want the tactics to do? Just trying to get clarity on why you're doing anything. Most people don't have a clue why they're doing anything. There's no profound purpose behind it. There's no method to their madness. It's a very tactical and static activity. And it's tragic because the same effort or time or expense or activity or opportunity could be doing such an incredible strategic job of advancing and enhancing your long-term strategic marketing goal. So these are pretty self-explanatory. Then later in there, I don't know what page it is, it's called deployment resources and responsibilities. It tells you the tactic you're doing. It's got a budget, either a time budget or a cost budget. You list all the steps you've got to go through to do it. You list the resources you need. You identify who is responsible for doing it. And you can put a time schedule when you're going to test it or try it. Now, apologies to you. I took this template from a great big $15,000 program we do. It's been condensed so I could put it in your book. When you go home, make it big enough that you got plenty of room. And make plenty of copies so you're not limiting. Don't limit yourself just by the size. If you want to write, you know, if your resources take that much space, give yourself that much. Use good judgment, okay? This is just a model for you to start with. Does that make sense, Raymond? Yes?
Yes.
All right, cool. Then at the end, my master marketing plan, you transfer what you've done and it just goes through and it's pretty self-explanatory. That's it.
Okay. There are 2 points that I would like to make. One is, the question comes up sometimes, why don't we just walk you through this step by step and teach you how to do each exercise in this amount of time? There's a reason for that. Every business in this room is different. There's 500 and some people here, probably 350 businesses. Some areas of this template are going to be more important, are going to be more impactful for an individual business. So you have to do this work and you have to do this exercise by yourself. The second thing that I would encourage you to do, because I know that there's some people that are here where there are a large number of people from the same company, do not do the exercise together. Do it separately because you
initially,
want your perspective.
Initially. Then see how differently each one of you answered and how many different interpretations or ideas come up.
Because this is the starting point of everything that you will be doing from this point forward. And everything that we've done for the first 2.5 days has been to bring you to this point so you can start to implement.
The readiness, you're ready now.
You can define this for your business, and when you go back, starting tomorrow morning or starting Monday morning, whenever you go back at the office, you can begin implementing exactly what you've learned, exactly what you've developed, and exactly what you've defined for your particular business.
Yeah. Our goal, I said it the first day, but it probably sailed over you. Our goal is twofold. We want to give you the basis to build yourself an extraordinarily growing, enduring, prosperous business, but we also want to give you activities, actions, and elements you can apply immediately to create profit windfalls, improve performance from what you're already doing right away, but we can't do it for you. There's only one person who can do it for you. Who is that? Yeah, you. So this is the first step to force you to start doing it. At other programs we've done, people go back and they don't do much if they don't have an initiation into this process. When they do this, people go back and they soar. So this is what you're going to do for the next 2 hours. Well, hour and 45. I'm sorry, because we got to bring it to a conclusion at about 6. And get your break, and then we're gonna talk to anybody who wants to talk about our 5-day program. But for an hour, for 1 hour, 45 minutes. Stay at your table. Don't leave unless you got to go to the bathroom. Force yourself to try to complete as much of this as deeply and meaningfully as you possibly can. This is probably one of the most critical things you will ever do in the rest of your business life. And this starting point can redefine your future, your success, your whole world and reality. Okay, Spike's going to take over. I'll be back in an hour and 45.